Scientists are using the world's largest robot
and a plant cell's tiniest molecules
to solve one of the biggest problems in agriculture, drought.
I'm in Arizona, one of the hottest, driest states in the US. But soon, this will be the norm in a lot more places. Climate change is causing severe heat and drought across the globe, threatening the stability of our food systems. The scientific community has come here to the desert to open a dialogue with plants to help them become more resilient in the face of these extremes. The Center for Research on Programmable Plant Systems is at the forefront of this work, and today we get to meet its scientists, visit their labs, and get a behind-the-scenes look at how they're solving these very urgent issues in agriculture.
First up, we're heading to the University of Arizona to meet biologists who are peering into the molecular world of plant signaling and communication. They're creating switches out of genetic building blocks to program plants with the ability to withstand heat and drought stress. I cannot wait to see how they do it.
Hi, Molly.
Hey, Jesse. Hi.
Welcome to Arizona.
Thanks so much. I'm so excited to be here.
Should I take you to the lab?
Absolutely.
I'm a molecular biologist at the University of Arizona, where I'm an associate professor in the School of Plant Sciences. I started my lab with the goal of studying how plant cells are responding to the environment. But now within the crops project, we want to take our understanding of those signals at the level of the single cell and see how that fits into the whole plant. With climate change, those stresses are becoming more and more severe, and plants don't necessarily have the ability to sense and respond to that level, that extreme changes in the environment. We just need to have the right people coming in and really dedicating their careers to finding solutions. So great, Molly, this is the crops team right here.
Getting to study and better define these unknown molecular mechanisms in plants. This is really information that we can use to produce plants that can survive in a wider range of climates. So one of the projects that we're working on is to develop special tools that give us specific control of the formation of reactive oxygen species.
Let's talk about reactive oxygen species for a second, because they are the bread and butter of the Woodson Labs research. ROS, as they're called by the pros, are super reactive molecules that contain oxygen whose electrons are behaving a little funky. They're produced when plants experience stress, and in large quantities, they can cause tissue damage and even cell death. But in small amounts, they serve as critical signaling molecules that let the plant know that there's something stressful going on and that they should turn genes on and off that could help the plant out. The Woodson Lab is using these ROS signals to communicate with plants. So we're going to stress out some plants today?
We are. Here's some Nicotiana leaves that I've subjected to different types of stress. Just looking at them, you can't really tell that big of a difference.
Let me put them in the science box. Now what happens?
This nice tool called the floor cam, it basically flashes bright lights at the leaves and measures chlorophyll fluorescence.
Whoa.
The more red you have on the scale, the more fluorescence and the healthier the plant is. You can see in an untreated plant, it's orange, it's a happy leaf. But when we subject that leaf to a lot of heat stress, suddenly it's dipping into the blue. It's not happy.
Oh, sorry,
we're making
guys.
The plants blue.
Rescue him. So once we have a way to measure how stressed the plants are, how does that tie into your reactive oxygen species work?
So what we're hoping to do is to basically control ROS production without subjecting plants to stress, and that'll be something that we ideally can measure with our floor cam.
Oh, cool. So you can say like, hey, even though this plant isn't stressed, we're still getting it to produce this stress response signal.
Exactly.
But why does the Woodson Lab want plants to send stress signals when they're not actually stressed? Well,
my project is developing optogenetic tools to turn certain genes on and off to improve water and nitrogen usage efficiency in plants.
And optogenetic tools can be turned on and off with light signals, right?
Yeah, plants have different proteins that react to different light wavelengths, and so we're harnessing those native proteins and using them to induce our own genes that we want.
Wow, so plants already have these like built-in light switches, and you're able to kind of isolate those switches and attach them like to something that you want to control within the plant.
Yeah, exactly.
That's so cool.
Yeah. I built a light-inducible gene expression system where we can turn a gene on with red light and then immediately turn it off with far red light. When we turn that gene on, it'll produce a lot of ROS, and that should initiate the plant to start turning on other genes in order to acclimate to a stress.
Wow, so instead of actually stressing the plant out and it producing ROS because of that,
You're giving it a switch that can turn on the ROS without actually having to stress the plant out.
Yeah, exactly. And we're hoping that by doing that, the plant will acclimate to this stress, even though it's us turning on ROS, and it'll be better resilient to a potential stress.
You're like preparing it for the test almost. Yeah. You're helping it with its homework. Okay, so we're gonna actually put this switch into this plant right now.
Yes.
Cool. Safety first.
Here in our syringe, we have Agrobacterium, which is a naturally occurring bacterium that contains the genetic components that we want. And what we'll be doing is just flipping the leaf and inserting the liquid. The leaf will absorb it, and the Agrobacterium will insert the genetic components into the cells of the leaf.
Oh, wow. You can really see it spread. That's so cool.
Now it's your turn.
Oh, my God. I'm so excited. Okay. Oh my God. It's happening. I just gave it a new switch.
So now we can stick them into our light chamber that will shine red light and turn on the genetic switch and turn on ROS production. Eventually, we want to move it to be expressed in the root tissue because ambient light can affect the switch system, which begs the question, how are you going to shine light below ground? We're working with roboticists and engineers at Cornell that are developing soil robots that will actually crawl underground and shine light at the individual roots to turn on and to turn off this gene expression system.
Oh my. I gotta see those robots.
So I took a quick trip to Cornell University, also part of the Crops Network, so I could do just that.
Hey Anand.
Hey Molly. Welcome to the lab where we build our robots. They wanted to initiate the signal in the roots. We need technology so that we can make it, move it, and reach the roots.
So how does the robot get to the roots then?
We are actually building a tube-like robots. And what we are trying to do is we are going to integrate LEDs that can actually help them to trigger the signal. But the thing is, this robot has to be very fast. So that's why we are using air pressure to actually move them. The idea is to use like pneumatic controlled robotic parts that we can reach to different roots.
So there'd be like a network of tubes like throughout an entire field.
Exactly, yeah.
Tell me if this is right. Here's the picture. We have a cornfield. There's a drought coming. You already have your network of tubes like deployed in the field. So you can say, hey robots, go send all of these red, far red signals to these plants. Mm-hmm. And they can go and they can do their little light signals, and that'll turn on all of the genes in the cornfield that'll help the corn roots kind of forage for more water, and then they'll be prepared for the drought ahead of time.
Exactly.
Okay, mind blown. Back to Arizona, where Nathaniel is going to blow our minds some more.
One of the goals of my postdoctoral work is to sort of bridge the gap between laboratory science and field-based crop growing. The idea for this is we can create what we call sentinel plants. So these are plants that when they encounter stresses in a crop scenario, they should turn red.
We have a stress plant. Your amazing molecular biology is going to allow that plant to convert a stress signal into a visual signal that we humans can understand, and then we can help the plant out.
Correct. We're using a reporter construct in the lab right now that's called Ruby, which is a gene that creates a red pigment in the plant that you can see with your eye. So this is an example of what a reporter plant might look like, where you have patches of the plant that are turning red.
It's so red. That is such an obvious signal. It's like, I am stressed.
Once we connect the stress puzzle piece with the reporter puzzle piece, we can generate crop plants that farmers can take into the fields and plant amongst their food crops.
So they would be in the field with the regular plants, but give a farmer an idea of like when the first moment that the plant starts to experience a stress, it would give this bright visual signal so we could intervene sooner, save the plants before they get damaged.
Exactly.
That is really amazing.
And guess what? Anand has a robot for that too.
This is a soft robotic gripper connected with the robotic manipulator. So the idea is building this above ground robot is to do the measurement with sentinel plants. So imagine right now it can grab a leaf, then it can have a camera, and with the camera you can do the color measurement.
So you're saying like this gripper could kind of roam through the fields and be taking pictures of plants and detect that Ruby signal before we can even see it.
Exactly.
Way to go, little guy. So the long-term goal is to have these deployed, moving through the fields,
yeah,
gently, grabbing plants and saying, hey, are you stressed? And then relaying that information to the farmers.
Yeah, exactly.
We just saw how crop scientists are communicating with plants using intricate, minute molecular signals to help plants survive in a hotter and drier world. And now, it's time to zoom out and meet crops researchers who are working towards the same goal, but from a macro perspective. They're using giant robots to gather epic amounts of data and generate digital models of entire fields of plants.
Oh, hey guys.
Oh, hey there, Molly. Welcome to Maricopa Agricultural Center.
Thanks, I'm so excited to be here.
We're the Pauli Lab at the University of Arizona, where we focus on plant water uptake and learning more about it through hydroponic plants.
High throughput phenotyping means collecting vast amounts of plant trait data, which is key to unlocking how they respond to drought. We're gonna see so much Pauli Lab data collection. They use sensors, robots, drones. Let's get into it.
So Clay, we are in a really hot cotton field right now. These plants must be so stressed out. What are you trying to find out about them?
I focus a lot on the water sector, how cotton uses water.
So these sensors measure stem water potential. Stem water potential is kind of a measure of plant stress and how much water these plants have access to.
Let's take a look at how water moves through plants. Water in the soil enters a plant through its roots, travels up the stem in special pipe-like vascular cells called xylem, and then exits the leaves through tiny mouth-like openings called stomata. The dryness in the atmosphere pulls the water out of the stomata. This process is called transpiration, and it supplies a plant's cells with water for critical processes like photosynthesis. Because water molecules stick to each other and to the cells of the xylem, there's a continuous stream of water, from the soil to the roots to the stem to the leaf to the atmosphere. During a drought, the atmosphere is pulling the water, and there's not enough in the ground to supply and keep the stream going. This can eventually kill the plant if it's severe enough. But plants actually have steps they can take to mitigate the impact of drought. For example, they could close their stomata to keep the water inside, or they could change how their roots grow to forage for more water in the ground. These mitigation strategies are what the Pauli Lab is harnessing with their work.
So we want a measure of their stress continuously, because it's really important and something that it hasn't really been studied is how they respond to stress over time. So once these sensors are installed, they will record data continuously every 20 minutes, and then that gets transmitted to the cloud via cell signal, and so we can just be on the computer looking at how stressed these are.
In the air conditioning.
In the air conditioning, absolutely.
How many sensors are we talking?
So we are going to install 36 sensors.
Wow, that's so much data.
Yeah.
And you want to figure out what traits or like what varieties of cotton are really good at using water, and then like drilling down into the genetics behind those traits?
Yeah, absolutely. We grow like 20 or 30 varieties of cotton to figure out as much as we can with all the data we collect.
Sebastian, we are standing on top of the world's biggest robot. I'm still not over it. What's its job? What's it do? What's it in this field for?
So what we're standing on is, it goes by a lot of names, the gantry, the field scanalyzer, but essentially it is the world's largest phenotyping robot. It weighs about 30 tons and it has approximately 5 different sensors on board. RGB sensors, thermal, hyperspectral, chlorophyll fluorescence, and 3D laser. And so what that allows us to do is it allows us to capture all sorts of data throughout the entire growth season of the particular crop that we're growing under it.
Wow, how often does it run?
We can do scans multiple a day, depending on the sensor. If we're running all the sensors throughout the week, you can collect up to about a terabyte of data.
Holy cow. So you're able to collect data throughout the growing season, keeping track of like each individual plant in the field?
Yeah, that's correct. We've gotten our data processing to the point where we can track individual plant growth and measurements.
That's wild. My brain can't even understand that level of data. Yeah,
we really need to be able to understand how some of these crops respond to these drought or water limiting conditions. And so scanning and measuring traits, what we're doing to this at this caliber, allows us to better understand that response.
Okay, you got robots, you got drones too?
Yep, that's right. What we use the drones for is similar to the gantry. It's just a little bit more scalable. Right? So not everybody can have a gantry system, but most people can purchase a drone.
Sure.
We're taking different kinds of imagery, just like the gantry system, with RGB, there's some that are thermal, we have a multispectral camera, flying it over our fields, and we're able to collect all the data that we want with these drones.
So similar, like keeping track of each plant in the field kind of thing.
Exactly, oh, yeah. But the thing with now is because we have different sensors in this field that mm-hmm. we don't in the other, mm-hmm. Which is kind of what you were hearing about with Clay, is we can now begin to tie this data together. Seeing some of these traits that we're looking and measuring at.
All the sort of big, high level like phenotyping stuff and then the nitty gritty in the ground in the sensors, you can combine all of that, get like a full picture of what's going on.
Exactly.
That's amazing.
So Clay, we've just seen you guys collect like absurd amounts of data. What do you do to put it all together?
We use math, physics, and kind of what we know about the biology of these plants to describe how water moves throughout the plant. Using formulas, implementing some biophysical models.
Wow, so you're basically taking all these traits you've measured and putting them into a model that then can generate new information about how a plant might deal with climate change and stress.
Yeah, absolutely.
Kind of the main goal for this data, at least related to crops, is to create something known as a digital twin. Mm-hmm. So a digital twin is essentially like an in silico or kind of in the computer space version of your plant. So you want it to be as accurate and as representative of the plant that's being grown in the field as possible.
These models really allow you to open this dialogue with plants.
Yeah, having models, one, allows us to kind of capture data at a more frequent rate. And then with the trait that we could capture, like root length, early stomatal closure, and high stress environments, these are traits that we're targeting to help us with this dialogue. Our research is really kind of the first step in like developing better plants. Uh-huh. We need to understand the plant and then find the target, these traits that matter in specific environments.
If we have the correct data that we collect, we can do different kind of predictive models.
Wow.
And that allows us to kind of run these scenario analyses. So for example, different environments, you could see how it reacts based on the data that we've already collected. But that data needs to have high resolution. Mm-hmm. And so that's why a robot like this is, right. is important.
You need it like in order to answer those questions.
Which will allow us and other scientists in the future to kind of tackle some of these problems that we're facing.
Good job, robot. And good job, scientist.
Thank you.
On the data side and the research side, I have learned so much being a part of crops and had so much help outside of my own lab, working with kind of the engineers, the roboticists, the molecular side of crops is such a vast amount of knowledge to be able to tap into.
Crops has been great, both for the research and both for the knowledge that I've gained from my peers, just because it's multidisciplinary.
A multidisciplinary approach is central to the crops mission. Crops researchers across its partner institutions are not only developing new technologies, they're actively researching public perception of these technologies and using that to guide their design and deployment.
I collaborated with a social science graduate student at Cornell University in Bruce Lewinstein's lab.
At Crops, we're interested in understanding what are the social and ethical consequences of all this amazing plant science and engineering research that people are doing. Christian came to our group and was like, hey, I want to do this project. So we developed this really cool project together.
We surveyed migrant farm workers in Yuma County to see what their views and visions are on our technology. They commute daily from Mexico to work in the fields in the United States. Farm workers are generally unrepresented in these kinds of studies, and it's important to know what they think about this technology since they're going to be working hands-on with the plants and the technology that we're developing.
We were at an event called Dia del Campesino. It's an annual event that brings together over 3,000 farm workers to celebrate all the contributions they do for the agriculture industry. We got in contact with the community organizers, and we developed a survey with them as well. We really wanted to be like grounded in this kind of community type perspective. We saw that a lot of the farm workers were really trusting of university scientists, which I think is really promising for us at Crops. They actually ranked reducing water use as one of their top three goals of the agricultural biotechnologies that Crops is producing.
Hopefully with those insights, we'll better know how to equitably distribute this type of technology, not just in the US, but across the world.
That's really great to hear that Crops is being so careful and thorough about these kinds of considerations with the research. You have these measures in place from day one to make sure that everyone is happy.
The goal is really to create technologies that aren't just environmentally sustainable, but also socially sustainable.
We're talking about some pretty heavy subjects today, climate change, food security. What gives you hope as a scientist working on these things?
Just the sheer volume of people working on kind of this drought research is so impressive that it really, I mean, it gives me hope that there is a way forward.
We're starting to see some evidence of certain varieties of cotton that are showing some tolerance to drought. So it is giving hope because it's not just a pipe dream.
Not just scientists, but the public both want foods on their tables, and so we're both working together to make that happen.
I don't know about you, but sometimes I get really overwhelmed when I think about climate change and the challenges it poses to our world. But spending time with Crops researchers has really given me a sense of hope. It's so amazing to see all of these scientists, all of these great minds come together to collaborate and solve these huge problems that we're facing. This is what happens when we open a dialogue with plants. New ways to learn, new ways to communicate, new discoveries and advances that can make our world a better place.